so we can open this meeting with your prayer. Mr. Bentine.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Lord, we thank you for this day and the many blessings we have received. We thank you for the ability to use our minds and work together to create strong and healthy communities. We thank you for looking over our constituents and all who we serve. Lord, we pray for all in our communities who are hungry, who are ill, who live in violence. As these meetings or proceedings begins today, Lord, please provide each person here with clarity of mind, creativity, compassion, integrity, and a sense of humor. Lord, give us listening ears, thoughtful words, and an open heart as we meet here today. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Renton. Good evening. Welcome to the Standing Committee on Social Development. We're here to talk today to talk about junior kindergarten. Just so people are aware, the processes we're hearing information and concerns from the communities as pertaining to junior kindergarten. We do not have the power to make final decisions. We make recommendations, and there is a process. So there's a budget process. There will be an LP process that goes out, the Education Act. It's going to be out there, so people have the opportunity to say those concerns and that. At this point in time, can I get somebody to make a motion to adopt the agenda as we have in front of us with the public hearing? Mr. Beaulieu, on the screen. All in favor? Opposed? Thank you. At this point in time, I'll just get my colleagues to introduce themselves, and starting on the right with Mr. O'Reilly.
Kevin O'Reilly, Frame Lake.
Julie Green, Yellowknife Center. Thank you for coming.
Michael Natalie, MLA for Ditchell.
Danny McNeely, Santu Region.
Thank you for coming. Corey Vanthine, MLA for Yellowknife North.
Tom Beaulieu, MLA for Tuneda and Willowday.
Welcome, everyone. Frederick Blake, MLA for Mackenzie Delta.
Thank you. I should have introduced myself. Shane Thompson, the Hindi. I'm also the chair of the Social Development Committee. On my left-hand side is Ms. Walsh. She's our researcher. This empty chair is actually our clerk, Doug Shardy, who is out photocopying something for us presently. At this point in time, we have the school board chairs, Mr. Stevenson, Mr. Walsh, and Ms. Kerrigan? Kareen, sorry. So at this point in time, I'll ask you guys to introduce yourselves. If you guys are going to change speakers, if you can address us to, that you're changing it to me, and at that point in time, I'll recognize the next speaker so that we can move on. So, and it's for the record, so we know who's, if there's changes in there. So which individual would like to start? Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much. Do I need to press anything here? Is this all?
No, it's our research or our audios.
Oh, okay. Thanks very much. And by way of introductions, on my right is Yvonne Kareen. She's the Directrice Générale of the Commission Scolaire. And Miles Welsh is the chair of Yellowknife Catholic Schools, and I am the chair of Yellowknife District Education Number 1. So we are here not representing our particular boards, but as representatives, the NWT chairs of education. So we're quite pleased to be here, and thank you very much for the invitation. Julie Green sent to us, and I have never previously been invited to a standing committee. I've often met with MLAs and been invited to meet with groups of MLAs, so I greatly appreciated that, and I see it as an example of the kind of open governance that this legislative assembly came to your positions in. So thank you for that. So, and I also want to say that some of the positions that we're speaking about are coming from the collective of the NWT chairs, but it's not necessarily sanctioned by every single board in the Northwest Territories because they've not had time to have their public board meeting. We work on a basis of public government, and our meetings are public, but not every board has had that meeting. So we're representing the chairs of the Northwest Territories and not our individual boards. We did meet with the minister last Friday. It was a very positive meeting in terms of the atmosphere. And again, I compliment the minister on his openness to hear us. And for the first time anyone had ever recollected, the minister and the chairs co-authored a joint press release that went out to reflect the actual comments that we provided to the minister, and that was very valuable to us to have that kind of respect shown to the concerns that we had collectively brought to that hall, and we really felt heard. We didn't necessarily get the answers we wanted, but we felt heard by the minister and by the staff there. And generally, I find that for myself, the relationship with the minister is very positive, and the reports I get from our administration is very positive in terms of the current Department of Education. So by all means, I'm showing tremendous respect and appreciation for the educators in our Northwest Territories, both in the department, the minister's office, and all the hardworking people in our school boards. So following the minister's meeting, and I'm sure you're aware of it, but just a summary, following the meeting with the minister, there was a media briefing that the minister gave to the media on Monday, and then on Wednesday, the minister presented to yourselves, and then you added this extra evening for us to attend. And, you know, we're quite aware that there are many aspects to the implementation of junior kindergarten. I've had officials and parents talk to me about concerns with the implementation, but our primary concern is to do with the overall funding. That's our number one concern, to implement a very valuable program in the Northwest Territories with the funding that it requires. And we do recognize the fiscal situation. No question, there are challenges. Revenues are down. We have a briefing from the Department of Education and from the GNWT on the fiscal realities, and that's no mystery to us, and we fully respect that, and we know that you folks are part of the decision-making process that is quite challenged to make things work with reduced financial resources. And so I don't think there's anybody in this room that would argue that education is a priority. We would all agree with that. And our territory is faced with many other tremendous priorities of health and infrastructure. But when I think of infrastructure, we often think of bridges and roads and hard surface things. But I'd like to propose that the children in our society are an important infrastructure, and that the investments that we will make through education are of tremendous value to the growth of our society. And the kids that are in our schools right now are the ones that are going to be us in the next generation in 30, 40, 50 years. How many years, Tom? in future years, they will be here being us. So we want them to be the best that they can be through the education process. And that's our job as school boards, as educators, is to take the resources that are provided to us to provide the best education, given the guidance of curriculum, given the guidance of current society expectations, from the requests and expectations of parents. We do the best we can to provide the best education in our schools. And we think we do well. We think we do a good job. And if there aren't quite as many dollars as we think we should have, we will continue to do a good job. We're good at what we do in our schools. We're good at what we do in our school boards. And we'll do a good job. But we think we can do better. We think we can do better if we have the resources that are needed to implement these new initiatives. So much has been said about changing how we do things, making do, adjusting, and we do. We continue to adjust in our schools. We continue to make do. But the accumulated effect over the years has added up, and so we have a number of things that we want to bring to your attention as we get into the substance of the piece that we provided to you. So in terms of junior kindergarten, no question, this is a very valuable initiative to provide a free to parents, play-based education experience for four-year-olds, some of whom will be three when they first show up at the door. No question, this isn't anything to do with arguments against that as a valuable educational experience. And this is not at all to diminish other excellent early childhood education opportunities such as Montessori, Yellowknife Play School, Aboriginal Head Start, and for the very valuable attention of concerned parents that choose to keep their children at home for some of those early years. You can't beat engaged parents for the early childhood experience. So this opportunity to educate four-year-olds, I think personally, is something that we welcome. In many of our schools, we already have a place preschool experience happening, so there is experience in many of our schools in doing this. Junior kindergarten will be good for kids, will be good for parents, will be good for schools, so it's a good thing. But our number one comment that we've made ever since this was first rolled out was it was deserving of the full resources that it was needed to pay for the costs of the program. When it first rolled out, there were virtually no extra dollars, so our mantra was that it was 14 grades of education with 13 grades of funding. Well, it's improved quite a bit, so the minister, to his credit, and to the government, to their credit, have put additional dollars on the table. And you know, it's hard to keep track of the numbers. They keep evolving. The first cost was $7 million, then it was $6 million, now it's $5 million. We won't really know until we really start to deliver it. But based on the latest numbers, $5 million is the cost of junior kindergarten. The government says they've got two, and we got to come up with three over the Northwest Territories. And that's a fair bit of money. I know if you put it into perspective and you put it into percentages, but if you count it in the number of teachers, that's a lot of people in the classroom providing education, and often the ones that aren't that will lose the spot in the staff are the arts and the other things, as was pointed out to me by the president of the NWTTA before the meeting. And those teachers that aren't then in the schools aren't doing the extra stuff that so many teachers do in way of sports and drama and so on. So the impact will be significant and it will be felt. And it is an accumulated effect that we have experienced in other areas. And so I will move to the... I will ask Miles Welsh to speak to a letter that we did receive. So at 5 p.m. today, we did receive a letter from the minister that did address some of our concerns. And so I'll let Miles speak to that, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. Mr. Welsh.
Thank you. I guess following our meeting with the minister and the meeting that took place yesterday led to this letter that we received this evening. So we're quite pleased that that the minister was responding to some of our concerns. There was some adjustments to the inclusive schooling funding, and I have to put a caveat in here. I haven't had a chance to sit down and analyze this letter. So as I understand, there's going to be $1.3 million put back into inclusive schooling, and that, of course, is a positive. And there's also some adjustments to the to address the concerns about the salaries. I haven't been able to do any calculations on that. But as John said, we're still concerned, recognizing fully the merits of junior kindergarten. The fact that it is not fully funded remains one of our concerns. Now, as I said, we have to reserve judgment on this letter, not only until we have a chance to analyze it, but till we have a chance to see how this plays out actually in our final budget allocation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much. So moving to some of the key messages that we shared with you in a document, and as I mentioned before, we're committed to providing the best possible education for all of our students. This has become an increasingly difficult task given some of the following things, and these are some elements that school boards have raised over the past year. So number one, and I'll speak to number one and two, and then I will pass the microphone to Yvonne Kareen. So number one, the GNWT funds the third worst student-to-educator ratio, which is the pupil-teacher ratio, or PTR, of all the 13 provinces and territories in Canada, according to the most recent Stats Canada data. And there's a website link there. Despite having the second highest ratio of students with special needs, the second highest percentage of students in smaller schools that don't have the economy of scale to offset a poor PTR. And there's an example there that a school in Toronto of 2,000 students requires just one principal, whereas 20 NWT schools of 100 students and each requires 20 principals, which means that principals are counted in the calculations. So you would think that just based on the numbers, given the large number of small communities, small schools, that just based on the numbers, we would have a more favorable parent or pupil-teacher ratio. Number two, NWT school boards have been historically underfunded in a number of other areas. School boards are required to spend more than the GNWT spends each year on casual substitute teacher over expenditures. An ECE review confirmed that GNWT allocations to school boards are significantly less than the actual cost required to hire substitute school employees per the GNWT negotiated leave provisions, over $1 million less per year. Pension buybacks were unfunded. Salary increments, boards are funded based on prior year salaries. Technology personnel and support, which is generally an unfunded category of school services until this year when there was one PY added by further underfunding all other admin salary benefit lines. So there was no new money essentially in the technology category. So, Mr. Chair, I will pass the mic to Yvonne Kareen.
Thank you, Mr. Stephenson. Mr. Stephenson, Ms. Green.
So the third point we'd like to bring to your attention tonight is that school boards have also incurred significant reductions already. So in addition to the above underfunding, and despite what is being said otherwise, inclusive schooling dollars, so special needs funding, percentages have decreased starting in 2010, along with a reduction in 2012, and an even more significant reduction in 2016, and proposed further reductions in 2017 and 2018 as well. Indexing to inflation, a number of funding line items have not been indexed to keep up with inflation, so CPI increased 25% or more over 10 years, such that the buying power of the same allocations has decreased by 25% in 10 years, including the following line, the lines that saw no increases in well over 10 years. So Aboriginal language O&M, student busing, DEA administration, administration O&M, program support, which is the funding line used to hire special needs assistants. We can't hire as many now as we could 10 years ago with the same money, et cetera. In point four, despite this, the GNWT has decided to implement new initiatives in a time of fiscal restraint with insufficient funding and through further reductions in funding to school boards. So we have junior kindergarten, which is what we're here to speak of tonight. So in 2014, ECE estimated the cost of this program at $7 million per year. All but $2 million of this total is being paid for through redistribution of existing school board allocations. Education is about $2 million a year. New money for ECE funded largely by reductions to school boards due to enrollment decreases, which is fair enough. Territorial support team and training, $1.5 to $2 million a year to be funded through further reductions to the school board starting in 2016-17. So if I can pass the baton back to John.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Mr. Stephenson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So in the box there, it summarizes the comments that we made to the minister last Friday, and we appreciated the opportunity to share them with you. So the one was change the Education Act reference from 16 to 1 student-teacher ratio to a better than Canadian average, which is 13.8 to 1, which was spoken to in our earlier part of the presentation. I'll turn the mic to Mr. What's his name?
Walsh.
Mr. What's his name? Or yeah. Mr. Walsh. Mr. Walsh. Thank you, Mr. Stevenson.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, John. At the meeting with the minister, we spent a fair deal of time discussing new initiatives, ER, and those items. And what we made clear, we believe, to the minister was our support for all these ideas. But once again, bringing forth all these new initiatives without the proper funding to support them is not a setup for success. Especially we'll take the junior kindergarten, for example, and moving that money out of other programming to support junior kindergarten harms a lot of the other students and a lot of the other programs along the way up. So if you're going to continue on with these ideas and these initiatives, perhaps they need to be more strategically thought out so they can be implemented properly with the proper funding guaranteeing success.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh.
Thank you.
Microphone to Yvonne. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
So, this evening at 5 o'clock, we did receive a letter, as we said, from the minister, and some of the points that we're going to be touching on and that we have touched on already are pieces that he alluded to in this letter, which we received at 5 o'clock, so we haven't had time to analyze. Some of these issues that we're bringing up, we know are spoken of in that letter. We don't know what impact they're going to have. So just to preface what we're bringing up to the table now. So the number three is one of those that we believe have been addressed in the letter, but we don't know what the impact of it is going to be at this time. So we're going to bring it forth anyway. Funding actual employee salary and benefit costs, including substitute teacher costs, as per GNWT negotiated pay, benefits, and leave provisions. Right now, the proposal is that funding midpoints of salary pay bands saves the GNWT money, but school boards still have to pay the actual costs the GNWT negotiated. So these salaries are negotiated in collective agreements, and we have to follow the collective agreements. We're not getting the funding to pay the actual salaries. That's the proposal. That's one of the cuts that we're living through right now, based on what we have heard on Friday, which may be corrected in the letter we received at 5, but we're not sure yet. Thanks, so Ms. I'm going to pass this back over to John now.
Thanks, Ms. Green.
To Miles. Sorry, Miles.
Thank you. Mr. Walsh.
Thank you very much. I'd like to read in a letter on behalf of the Beaufort Delta Education Council that was addressed to Mr. Shane Thompson and to Mr. Frederick Blake Jr. MLA Thompson and MLA Blake. Unfortunately, I am unable to attend in person the Thursday, December 8, 2016 public meeting on junior kindergarten that the Standing Committee on Social Development is hosting. I am requesting that you read the following information out loud on my behalf during the public consultation period about JK. It is important that the committee hear from our board and the facts about what is happening in Fort McPherson. As you are aware, Chief Julius School in Fort McPherson decided to offer half-day afternoon JK this 2016-2017 school year. This JK program runs opposite the morning Aboriginal Head Start program for four-year-old children. Both programs are run in the same school across the hall from one another. Since the beginning of the school year, BDEC has monitored the implementation of junior kindergarten at CJS. The supervisor of schools at BDEC has been on site a number of times to ensure that processes and procedures are being followed. I am pleased to share with the Standing Committee on Social Development and the public this evening that as the chairperson of the Beaufort Delta Education Council, I am proud of the programming being offered in Fort McPherson and across our regions, and that our students from JK to grade 12 are being well served and supported. With children as young as 3 years old in the school at CJS, the school administration acknowledged and effectively planned for their arrival. At the end of each school day, JK students are dismissed to their parents, guardians at 3 p.m., 30 minutes before K-9 students leave. This staggered approach to the end of the day ensures JK students have time and space for effective, safe departures from school with their parents or guardians. The Fort McPherson RCMP has worked collaboratively with the principal at Chief Julia School and BDEC to ensure the safety of anyone on school grounds. The RCMP has been instrumental in supporting a safe, caring environment at CJS. Chief Julia School's overall safety program is guided by the NWT Safety Act. CJS is in full compliance with the NWT Safety Act, outlining responsibilities for the employers, supervisors, and workers. Through our compliance with this act, the Beaufort Delta Education Council expresses its commitment to provide a healthy and safe work environment for everyone. BDEC has, quote, taken and will continue to take reasonable precautions and adopt and carry out reasonable techniques and procedures to ensure the health and safety of every person in the school, end quote. ECE Occupational Health and Safety Program, page 6. Any allegations or suggestions that there are any safety concerns that may impede the well-being of JK students is completely false. The safety of our students, staff, and public at Chief Julia School remains the top priority for the school and for our board. The principal at CJS was born and raised in the community of Fort McPherson, has intimate knowledge of the community and school, and has always had the best interests of the students she and her staff serve at the forefront. To suggest anything else would be false. BDEC's support of providing space in Chief Julia School for AHS reflects its commitment to supporting an effective, innovative, and creative education system for students. By offering junior kindergarten part-time and AHS part-time in Fort McPherson, parents are provided choice. Students can attend JK, AHS, both, or neither. It's up to the parents. Assertions to the contrary or about the overall safety of the building are troubling, unfounded, and wrong. Chief Julia School has been and continues to be a safe, supportive, inclusive place for all who attend. Yours in education, Lisa Semler, Chairperson, Beaufort Delta Education Council.
You were doing number four.
Oh, I thought you were telling me to read that one. If I may, I'm going to go back to our original document, and that was to speak to replenishing the inclusive schooling or the special needs money that were reduced from school boards in 2012 and further in 2016. As per the letter, and as Yvonne had mentioned, there has been some mention that we received tonight that there may have been something to support this, but I can't comment on that right now.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. In regards to the letter, is there any way we can get a copy of this letter? Because we haven't been aware of this letter. Yeah,
if for the record, Ms. Green.
Yeah. Sorry, Ms. Green, just for the record. Just say
sorry, I could send one later this evening.
Okay, to Mr. Showery. Because he'll get the correspondence to us that way. Okay, thank you, Ms. Green. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So just a few closing comments. We did have a statement there about setting goals and targets. I think it's always important, whatever we do, that we try to measure success. So that was a comment related to that. And as I said earlier, regardless of decisions that are made with the budget, we will continue to do our best to provide the best quality education possible within the resources that are assigned to us. It's what we do. So I thank you very much for this opportunity, for this audience. It's been quite a privilege, actually, to come into the House here and speak to you. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson, Mr. Walsh, Ms. Green. At this point in time, we're going to open the floor to my colleagues, and if they have any questions for you that they wish to ask. And Mr. Beaulieu.
On number two, in inside the box, territorial support team, is that the PSTs? Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Ms. Green.
No, it is not. The plan was to hire up to five or six specialists that would be in the realm of behavior specialist, trauma therapy specialist, speech pathologist, any one of those specialists. So it would be a team That would be, their home base would be Yellowknife, but they would travel to each of the school districts based on, there would have to be a plan set in place to for how often this team would travel to the different communities to address the needs in the small schools, in the schools that are very distanced from the home center of the regional office. What we felt, though, is that this the money that was being put aside for this team was not going to give us the biggest bang for the dollar, in the sense that in order to have a great impact on a student that's in difficulty, at risk, you need to spend a lot of time with them. And what this team was proposing or was proposed to do was to go into a school and to work with the principal and the program support teacher and the teacher to give advice, not to work necessarily directly with the students. And so we felt that for the amount of money that it would cost, it would not give impact that the department employees believe that it would have. If we had all the dollars and cents in the world, it would be the best thing if we could have one of those teams in each of the school districts. But we don't, and we're facing cuts. And is it now the time, after announcing junior kindergarten implementation and all of the other cuts that came with it, and for some boards that have fewer students this year than had last, and you're funded on the students that you had the previous September 30th, if you suffered a loss on top of the cuts, on top of the junior kindergarten, is it really time to spend $1.5 million on that type of territorial support team? So as a group, as a collective, unanimously, we said, the chairs and the superintendents, that was one project or one initiative that we hoped that they would reconsider. And it made mention of it in the letter this evening, but again, we haven't been able to digest that whole letter. We think that they've backed off on it, but we don't have confirmation until we're able to sit down and analyze that letter.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Mr. Blake.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. No, good presentation. Many of the concerns you brought forward is, you know, a lot of things that I too brought up in the House. You know, in order to bring on junior kindergarten, we have to have the proper resources, and you know, a lot of what you outlined here is some of the things that I have been bringing up. I know in the letter you also received from the Beaufort Delta Education Council. This is actually in my riding, Fort McPherson. You know, there's some challenges there because we have Aboriginal Head Start as well. And I know it is a federal funded program, but you know, I know they are concerned of junior kindergarten taking over many of their students. I know they are working half day. The Head Start program operates in the morning and JK in the afternoon. So there are parents that are making use of both programs, and you know, they are trying to work together. And I know there are some challenges there, though, and I'm sure we'll hear about that later today. But you know, I'd just like to say that I do share all your concerns here, and we'll be sure to bring that up in the February, March sitting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blake. More of a comment. Does any other, Mr. McNeil?
I got one question that may lead to a second one here, John. Thank you, Mr. Chair, by the way. How challenging would it be to go internally and recover and put together the shortfall of $3 million as these numbers are coming out? You have a contribution of 2 or 1.5, and you're looking at a shortfall for the overall program for a total of 5. How challenging would it be to come up internally for 3? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McNeely. Mr. Stevenson?
I'll give it a shot. Well, every school district goes through a budgeting process on an annual basis, given the the resources that are available to the district and the estimated costs that are coming up. So every year is a best estimate of enrollment and class sizes and so on, how many teachers are needed. So when you have a shortfall, you have a known reduction in funding, that has to factor into the plans. And so every school district, right to a school level, would have to make decisions on what was a priority and what was something that would need to be changed in order to cost less. So, yeah, it would be a challenge to every school board because the demands never decrease. We always are expected to do more. Our teachers are being pressured more and more to do more work with less resources. The expectations of parents, the expectations of society continue to increase. And so if you reduce the number of teachers, and that's the only way you can really address $3 million, those are positions. Each district would do their best to deal with that through retirement or resignation. It would presumably, each district would do their best not to actually affect people working in a job, but that would change the nature of schools when you take $3 million out, and I know the department puts it in the factor of a smaller percentage that makes it seem less important, but that still represents quite a number of resources in our NWT school boards.
Thank you, Mr. McNeely.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I throw that out in the spirit and intent of investing in our future assets, as you mentioned earlier in your presentation, John. One has to consider all the options available, so that's why I raised that first question. So, in fact, it is doable, but it's going to affect, in a domino pattern, other services within the structure of your board system. That's not my preferred choice. I think all our colleagues here feel the same. But I just want to see if it's doable internally. And as I mentioned, I will support the other options. I don't feel it's right to discredit the youth with the challenges we already face in the system we have here compared to elsewhere. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McNeely. More of a comment, Mr. Stevenson. At that time, Mr. Bolio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, just on the cost of some of the items that you've listed in the box, to change from 16 to 1 to 13.8 to 1 maybe requires 70 teachers, roughly, let's say, if we're talking about 8,000 students. Have you guys costed out that any of these items?
Thank you, Mr. Bolio.
Get it. I think that one of the issues is that the PTR that's actually in the Education Act right now is stated at 16 to 1, but that's not really the case. It's not the scenario in the schools. And I know that one of the things that was brought up is while you're going to be opening up the Education Act to make the change to add the junior kindergarten, may as well at this time also change the PTR to make it a realistic number. So that's the number one factor. The cost of it is that different people use different factors to calculate the PTR. And so our best guess is that the 13 to 8 to 1 is achievable. Would it add teachers? In my calculations, it wouldn't be 70. It would be less than that, especially with the fact that in the new inclusive schooling directive, they've added program support teachers, which are also counted in the PTR. So your calculation, in my estimation, is not quite right. Did I do an exact count? No, but it's not going to be that much of an increase. So basically, the intent was that if you're opening up the Education Act, you might as well put the right numbers in place for the PTR instead of the 16 to 1.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Mr. Bullock.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I was wondering if the chairs could give us an indication on how much inclusive schooling dollars were lost in the two reductions in 2013 and 2016.
Thank you, Mr. Beaulieu. Mr. Stevenson.
Some of these numbers, if you wish them, we can get back to you with those numbers, but we do not have the specific numbers. But there was a cut in inclusive education in 2012, and we were anticipating a further reduction there. And I know, speaking for my own school board, that's the one area that we've consistently advocated on as an area that we needed more funding for, and it's the one area where we seem to continue to get cut.
Ms. Green?
Oh, pardon. I could add that this year in 2016, the new inclusive schooling directive is where the big change is at, where we're talking about the cut, because basically what they've done is, without adding new money, they've adopted a new ministerial directive that adds program support teachers in each of the schools. But that funding is funding that is already in the school board. So basically, you have to reduce the number of classroom assistants that you have to have your program support teacher in place. And it's mandated that each school must have a program support teacher. So the cuts that we're living in 2016 are that one. And the other one was this territorial-based support team. And that led to significant cuts this year in 2016. In 2012, unfortunately, I wasn't in this position, so I can't speak specifically to it. But as John said, we can get you the numbers if you like.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Ms. Green?
No.
Any other questions? Mr. O'Reilly, and then.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. I guess I want to preface this question that I'm not advocating for this in any way, because I believe JK should be fully funded by GNWT, but it's my understanding that YK1 and YCS, you can use, of course, the LNIF tax base to help fund your systems. Is that something that you anticipate doing? So LNIF taxpayers may end up paying more to help fund JK. Is that something you can crystal ball far enough into the future yet? And I know that we don't really know all the costs and so on yet, but just wondering if that sort of might be in the cards. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Riley. Mr. Stevenson.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. So, yes, the two Yellowknife boards of Yellowknife Catholic Schools and YK1 receive about 80% of our funds from the GNWT and 20% from the City of Yellowknife through city taxes. And how it works is we let the city government know the amount of money that we need, and they establish the rate. So it is something within the purview of school boards to do, but it's not something that has been formally discussed by the school boards to raise the taxes. As you may have read recently, the city itself is considering raising taxes, so the appetite for further municipal taxes would probably be pretty thin.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. Mr. Riley?
No, thanks very much.
Okay. Mr. Van Thuyn?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I just need some clarification. On the inclusive schooling, you've indicated that there has been a number of years with reductions, and there is proposed further reductions coming in 17 and 18. We know that the number for JK inclusive altogether is it five or somewhere? It's moving around a little bit, but was there any indication within from the department that any part of the five or six or whatever the number is to be allocated for the inclusive schooling components that might be required for taking on four-year-olds?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Rentine.
Actually,
sorry, Ms. Green.
We were just making a comment that actually what was proposed by the department is that they would remove the junior kindergarten staff, and maybe I should let, I'll defer to John. He seemed like he had a good explanation. Okay, sorry, Miles.
Ms. Green, Mr. Walsh. Mr. Walsh.
Thank you very much. So as I understand in the discussions we had, the junior kindergarten students were actually taken out of the inclusive schooling funding calculation, and that provided another $1 million approximately to be put towards junior kindergarten. Of course, we felt that junior kindergarten children should be included in the inclusive school funding because you will have kids coming into junior kindergarten with special needs. To remove the funding that way, it made no sense at all to us. So we estimated that to be approximately $1 million. Those needs needed to be addressed. We can't wait till kindergarten to address the special needs of the junior kindergarten students.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. That's good. Is there any other questions from committee? I have a couple. My first one, in regards to your student teacher ratio, 16-1 in the Act. What is, and then the national average is 13.8-1. We've heard from the minister that our numbers are lower. What are you guys looking for as a number in the Act if it's 13-8-1? Because 12-1 for junior kindergarten presently, and that would be 16-1 for the other one, but it's 13.7-1, I believe, was the last number I heard. So what's the number are you guys looking for to change in the Act? Mr. Stevenson?
I can give it a try.
Just wait. Yep. Wait for the light to turn on. Thank you.
I can give it a try, and then I'll defer to John if he has more to add. Basically, I think what we are looking for is about a 13.4-1. And the reason is that for the number of students that are special needs students in the Northwest Territories, we have the highest per capita ratio of special needs students. We have the highest, the bigger distances to cover, so specialists have difficulty getting to the communities. So for many, many reasons, we believe that our PTR should actually be better than the national average. So that's why we were proposing 13.4.1 or 2.1.
Mr. Stevenson? Oh, thanks, Ms. Green. Mr. Stevenson?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. Yeah, the sense was that based on Statistics Canada, when this data was available, we were at Canadian average, and we believed we should be better. That if we want to be better at educating our kids, we need to improve that ratio. And so 13.4 seemed to be the number that our professionals were advising us on.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. I guess my next question is, have you guys looked at providing the numbers of what your actual school classroom sizes are? I know because we encompass the smaller communities, which still need teachers. Trust me, I know that, the importance of having teachers and special needs people in the class. But you guys know what your numbers are presently, student-teacher ratios per your schools in your districts right now? Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Those numbers can certainly be provided. That's tracked on an annual basis, what the class sizes are. Is that something you would?
Thank you, Mr. Stephen. Yeah, I'm just looking at when we're looking at the PTR ratio, looking at the national average of 13.4, with all the smaller communities and some of declining population in school enrollment, we could probably reach that without seeing any change to the number of students and that. So I'm trying to see what the big picture is. Like, we look at the territorial average, which is, I think it's 13.7-1. You're looking at 13.4, so we're looking at minimal amount of teachers being added to the system. But if we have a low enrollment, we could have you know, no change in it exactly. So, Ms. Green, you were about to say something?
Well, I was just going to...
Just wait till the red light goes on, please. Thank you.
I have to get used to this. I was just going to say that it's going to vary. I mean, if we take the Decho, for example, that has very small schools in very, very many of their communities, the PTR is going to be very different in the Decho than it would be at YK1 here in Yellowknife. So you'd have to do the territorial average, knowing that in each of the school districts, it's going to vary. So you can have a territorial average, but each of the school districts would have to provide you with those numbers.
Okay, thank you. If there's no further questions, I would like to thank you three for coming and presenting to the committee today, and we'll ask Mr. Wazug Chu to come up. And I apologize to David right now before.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, and thank you for your presentation.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and committee members. First, thank you very much for having this meeting. I know we talked about it for quite a bit of time, and the junior kindergarten issue has been an issue for quite some time now, and it's good to be able to inform committee a little bit of how it looks as an operator of an existing daycare preschool. First, just a little bit about the organization. The NWT Montessori Society has been in existence for about 42 years now. We've operated in many different forms. We operated a private elementary school for a period of time. We've been in various forms and staffing, and right now we have 80 licensed spots that are all just about all full, and about a dozen full-time staff and a number of part-time staff as well. So we're a fairly sizable organization delivering a Montessori CASA program here in Yellowknife, and it's for ages 2.5 to 4 years old. It can go as high as 5 on occasion for parents that have chosen not to use the kindergarten program as provided by ECE and have keep their children in our program. That puts us as probably one of the largest organizations running daycare in the NWT. You know, since junior kindergarten first came up almost 2 years ago now, or just over 2 years ago, we've had a number of concerns and been making recommendations for change. In preparing for this meeting, we pulled up some of the old letters we sent home to parents, and as far back as January of 2014, we've been asking for the same kind of changes and the same kind of information. So it's good that there's still conversation going on and that it hasn't all happened yet, but certainly I'm sure at least a few of you that have been hearing from us over all that time are getting to know the message pretty well. Today I'd like to talk about a few things in this process. We've met with MLAs before, we've met with the minister, we've met with the department a number of times, a number of deputy ministers as they've been changing. And there have been some changes to the program which are good, and recently there was an increase to the daily operating subsidy for existing program providers, and it went up for the first time in about 8 years from $10 a day to about $14 a day. So that's great. And right now, for your reference, that covers about 10% of our operating costs. With the increase, it'll probably cover about 12% of our operating costs. The rest of that now is made up of parent fees and user pay. Before I get into some of our specific recommendations, I want to talk a little bit about parents. Last week, the Society held a parent engagement night. It was sort of the first time we had parents all together talking about junior kindergarten. We had some representatives from ECE there, which was great to have that. And a lot of parents said it's the first time they've really heard any details about junior kindergarten. One of the troubles that we found is that people don't quite know what junior kindergarten is. Everyone says, well, I already have a four-year-old and they're in a program. That's just going to be free. And so it's taken a lot of work to talk to parents and say, well, it's not actually the same thing. So once you move to a school environment, it's very different than what you're getting from a licensed daycare preschool. It's a very different program. So going over the night, we had a number of questions. A number were answered, and there was a number of outstanding questions. And I just wanted to pass some of that parent feedback along to you, since not all the parents can have the opportunity to address the committee or address MLAs at all. One of the main concerns, and something that certainly society has been bringing up, is that junior kindergarten is optional. And this is the line, and it's always been the line. And it is optional, which is great, except that if you want to pick another option, it's still user pay. So you have the free option of junior kindergarten, or you're still paying roughly $8,000 a year, is what parents pay. In Yellowknife, services for a 2.5-year-old to a 4-year-old generally cost between $700 and $1,000 a month, depending on the organization, depending on after-school care or morning care, that sort of thing. And so a lot of parents felt that the idea of an optional service, well, the alternative was at quite an expensive amount, wasn't really an option for a lot of them, where a lot of parents expressed that they'd like to still pick an existing provider. And we hosted it in partnership with the Yellowknife Play School Association and some of their parents as well, wanting those services, but felt that just as, you know, trying to provide for a family, it's awfully hard to choose between spending a lot of money and having a free program for your child. So that was significant. Another one that came up was class sizes. So right now, as you were talking about earlier, class sizes are governed by a strict ratio. So right now, the ratio that applies in a facility of just 4-year-olds is 1 to 9. If you have a mixed age group, it's 1 to 8. So that's, for us, we all run mixed age programs. So there's always one staff person for every 8 children. And in fact, anytime you have more than 6 children in a room, you have to have a second staff person as well. That allows for help with going to the washroom, for all kinds of things, just to make sure that the kids are supervised. In a junior kindergarten environment, that ratio doesn't exist. There is no class size limit. There's no fixed piece. What does exist is the 12-to-1 funding PTR that we've been hearing about. And what that says is that the school boards are going to get funded as if there was a staff person for every 12 kids. But that's not connected at all to the class size. And that was of concern to a lot of parents. They said, well, you know, it's nice to know that there's a fixed size that it will never go above. And they were awfully concerned about, well, what's going to happen? Does this mean there really will be 12? Will it be 8 kids? Will it be 16? Will it be 20? How big is a junior kindergarten class going to get? And in general, the answer has always been that it's going to depend on the school. It'll depend on the environment. I know outside of Yellowknife and a lot of the smaller communities, junior kindergarten is a mixed class, a mixed grade environment. That likely wouldn't be the same case in Yellowknife, but it certainly was of concern to a lot of families. Another piece, of course, that was concerning was that the funding that we were hearing about earlier, and just that a lot of parents felt that it'd be great to get the free care for 4-year-olds, but certainly if it's coming at the expense of the education for their older children and as their children age through the system, that maybe there's not really a benefit. So they're saving, but long term, maybe they're not actually getting ahead at all. And then there are a number of other pieces to do with, will there be after-school care in schools? Can kids go on school buses? All kinds of questions like that. There aren't any answers for yet. And I think that was one of the biggest pieces of frustration for families, and for the society, is that we've been talking about junior kindergarten now for well over 2 years, and there's still so many unanswered questions about how it'll be implemented. Really difficult situation to be in because parents just don't know. And what nobody wants to hear is, well, we'll see what happens in September. Like the September will be the start of the year and we'll see how the classes look. So we're trying to avoid that. And I'd like to talk a little bit about some recommendations that we've been made over the last little while and a few that have been changing. Fundamental to all of them, though, is that one size doesn't fit all. The GNWT had an excellent review of the junior kindergarten program completed last year, and it was released earlier this year. And that review covered the program in existing communities and looked at the policy around it and what was happening. And one of the fundamental recommendations out of that report was that, JK, it looks different everywhere. And the care for 4-year-olds looks different in different communities. Some communities have paid services. Some don't have anything. Some have, very few students overall. Some communities, some years, don't have any 4-year-olds, whereas others have hundreds of 4-year-olds. And how do you balance that out? One of the key recommendations was simply that, one size doesn't fit all, and junior kindergarten can look different in different places. And if we're trying to meet the Assembly's goal of free, play-based care for 4-year-olds, there's different ways of doing that. And it's something we've been advocating for a long time, is being a partner in delivering this, rather than simply being left at the side or left behind in what's happening. So our first recommendation that we've been advocating for was that in communities that have an existing operating play-based care, so a licensed daycare, under the Act, that those facilities be funded to offer free care for four-year-olds. The idea here is that in communities that have the option, let parents have a choice of where to send their children, and it should be free to deliver that. It shouldn't just be you can pick one program in a school, or the other way you pick is going to cost you $10,000. It has to be free either way, so you can choose the kind of care that you like. Some kids are great in a school environment. Some four-year-olds aren't ready for it. Some of them prefer the smaller schoolhouse environment that we have. Some want, you know, there's all kinds of different things that work out better for kids, but not all of them work out great in a school. And what we've been saying over the years is that for us to deliver our program, we get a subsidy from ECE for every day, and parents pay. It costs about $10,000 a year. That's actually slightly less than ECE transfers to the school boards per student. Where we've had difficulty with this is saying it's actually cheaper for us to deliver care, and we have guaranteed class sizes, and we have ECE certified staff and a number of things that don't exist otherwise. And if we can do that for the same price or less, it's been, we think that it'd be awfully reasonable to make sure that money could follow the child and families could actually have a choice of where to register their students. So that's been sort of the main one we've been talking about for quite some time, since there already is all this capacity in communities. I mean, Yellowknife, Inuvik, Hay River, some of the other communities that have existing centers, why not take advantage of that? What we've been told is that, well, we'd like you to move to younger kids and care for younger children. And if we could add spaces for babies, it'd be great. For us, certainly that doesn't fit the model of education that we have. I mean, we're a preschool that teaches kids to write and read and speak, and the kids come out of it doing amazingly. That doesn't really extend down very well, and our building isn't even the right size for it. So without significant renovations, it doesn't really work very well for us. So instead, what we're going to end up having is going to be some wasted space in town, and that doesn't really make any sense when we can take advantage of it. So that's a big part of it. The second recommendation we've been making is that there's a whole bunch of questions that keep coming up about impact on existing facilities, people shutting down, people being open, but it's all just conjecture. And it's all facilities like us saying, hey, we know what kind of effect this will have on us, but there's been no government sort of research or projections on what that impact will look like. For a long time, when ECE workers weren't included in the junior kindergarten plan, we had been saying we knew we were going to be laying off about half of our workforce, and a number of other facilities were doing the same. The school boards at the time would have been laying off everybody. That's a big concern. There have been some changes made to that part of the program, and now school boards are optionally able to hire ECE workers. But it doesn't seem that some of that background piece has been done, and we're concerned about the effects on the broad community, including the fact that this may actually drive up the cost of care for younger children. This won't have any necessary impact on lowering that cost, but if other facilities start to close or reduce it, it won't actually help with availability of anything. So we think that work should be done before junior kindergarten is put in place. At the same time, just broadly in the NWT, there's communities that if they can't necessarily support two programs, but there's already a licensed provider, why not work with that provider and find out ways to expand it or change it rather than replace them? That's kind of what we're looking at even in Yellowknife, but if there are existing options, why not work more closely with them to deliver the care that's out there for delivery? Our final piece is simply that it doesn't make having this start next September when there's still so many unanswered questions doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. We've been told the implementation plan will be available in January, February of next year. That's great. For parents who normally get registered in January and February of next year, that's not a lot of time to make a decision. It's not a lot of time for significant changes to happen. There's still a lot of question marks, both for us, for our staff, for families, and that if you're going to bring in a program like this that is this significant a change to a community, having all of those things in place well in advance makes a lot more sense. The development of these plans needs to be done in partnership. So far, what we've heard is, and what we've been doing is we've been speaking a lot to the government about this program, but we haven't been engaged a whole lot about it. There haven't been too many changes that could work for existing providers. There have been a few for the school boards and how to implement it, but right from the start when this program first came out, the fact that it was going to be JK, it was going to be delivered in schools, the class sizes weren't going to be restricted, all of those things haven't changed. Those are things that people have flagged as issues for years, and there's been no changes to that. So working in actual partnership with existing providers is important. And we feel that even if it is delayed, they could immediately change the subsidy program, the way daycares are funded, and make care for four-year-olds free. There's nothing stopping that right now. It would be a funding change. It would be a bit of a policy change. But that could be done in the meantime while we get sorted out on what's actually going to happen with junior kindergarten. There was a delay put in place in this program originally. It was stopped to do the review, and then it was going to be reexamined and changed and come back. And in that whole period of, you know, about a year and a bit where they did this review, not much changed. Not much happened. All of a sudden, out of the blue last summer, it came out that, oh, junior kindergarten was happening next September again, but we don't have any plans yet. We'll get plans when we get there. That's really difficult to work with. And as an organization, I know you heard a presentation from ECE just yesterday, and you know they commented that the society, the Montessori Society, was very concerned about attendance. Quite honestly, that's not our concern. Our attendance will be fine. If we have to fill it up with three-year-olds, the program, there are certainly three-year-olds. We have a number of parents of four-year-olds who have been interested in still paying for services, and I don't think that they should have to, but they've expressed interest in it. If our program is smaller, the program will survive. It's been in many different implementations over the years and different sizes and versions. But it's about getting the right programming for the kids. And it's about making sure the staff are taken care of well. And that the kids and families are able to use the right programs and access the right services. It's not about the service providers that exist. I mean, we can change in size. If there's more kids, they grow. If there's less kids, you shrink. I mean, that's what happens, frankly, in Yellowknife overall. If there's not as many kids, it's a smaller program. Over the years, as there's been more growth, we've grown a bit. We can work with that, and we're more than happy to. But we need to work in an environment that, you know, it best suits the kids that we have. So it makes sense to make some of these changes to the program, but mostly it's... It'd be nice to be able to develop this program and look after the children in Yellowknife and the North in a collaborative way with the department and not simply, okay, we need to do something, let's move everybody to schools. So I just want to close with that. I know you've seen this, and I've talked to a number of you at different times. So thank you very much for hearing from us and for even having this meeting at all, for hearing from all the organizations. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Wislow. Do you have any questions for Ms. Green?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My question is whether you have any estimate of what it would cost to implement your first recommendation to fund existing facilities so that they can offer free care. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Mr. Lozicki.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. For an exact funding estimate, no. Well, I can tell you for each four-year-old, based on right now, ECU subsidizes each four-year-old in a program to the tune of about just, with the recent increase, just under $3,000 a year. That's what they currently fund. In schools, so in district-run programs, it's 75% of that number. So to simply fund the existing program would cost, the average is probably around $10,000 a year in, at least in Yellowknife, for a sort of an 830 to 330 program. So an additional $7,000 a student. Generally speaking, that's less than what's paid for kids in the other program. I mean, by the same right, the preschool programs that the boards run could be funded the same way, and the same programs could be continued to run, but free. Obviously, the junior kindergarten model moves kids from the Daycare Act to the Public Education Act, and that's the difference there. But funding-wise, there's, if anything, it's a little cheaper than funding under the Public Education Act. But I wouldn't have an exact number.
Thank you, Mr. Rose. Ms. Green?
And that's all. Thank you.
Any other questions? Mr. Beaulieu.
On your second recommendation, maybe I wrote it down as a recommendation, but otherwise being filled up at 2 and 3 year olds, how much would that increase the cost of those operations, whether it be daycare or Aboriginal Head Start or whatever it is?
Thank you, Mr. Beaulieu. Mr. Rosichu.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Somewhat it's going to depend on the number of students. So right now, part of the issue for us, of course, is the program is multi-year, so the older kids teach the younger kids, and it's a great program that way. Just having 2.5 and 3 year olds specifically won't raise the cost. It'll depend on how full the program gets. But right now, in Yellowknife, for example, looking at how many spaces there are for 3 year olds and 2.5 year olds, there's quite a few. There's not that many 2.5 and 3 year olds. So the issue comes is, you know, which facilities fill up first, and then what happens to the other ones. as providers close, or as it's harder to get spaces, then it could increase costs. In Ontario, when a similar program was implemented, it reduced the significantly reduced number of day homes, and that obviously has an impact then on prices, because again, that takes a certain number of spaces away. So off the top of my head, I don't know what that would do to fees, but it's availability that would be the big concern. All right. Any reduced availability of spaces for three-year-olds and under is a real problem.
Thank you. Any other questions? If not, we thank you very much for your presentation. And we'll bring the next person up, Ms. Chalmers. Ms. Chalmers and... No, that's not Michelle. That's Renee.
Renee?
Hi.
She's a
doctor. Oh, sorry. Doctor. Dr. Chalmers.
Mm-hmm. Can you repeat that maybe?
Yeah.
So on behalf of the...
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. I apologize for missing the doctor part. You're representing the Western Arctic Aboriginal Health Head Start Council. Correct. And who's the young lady beside you?
This is Joyce McLeod, who is also been delegated to represent the Western Arctic Aboriginal Head Start Council. I would also like to further clarify that I'm also representing myself, a licensed doctoral clinical psychologist, licensed in the Northwest Territories with an active membership. What we're going to present for you in the 15 minutes that we would like to, it's basically 2 points that are in the handout. In terms of what we would like to provide. The information was developed from a number of views and points. My golly gee, I forgot to thank the committee for the invitation. I'll go back to that. You didn't remind me to thank the committee. It's a late night, Christmas season, busy season. So I'd like to thank the committee for the invitation to present here, and I also want to thank the committee members for giving us this opportunity as well. What we're presenting today is a shortened presentation, and it includes 2 points on some general information that is available on public websites, and it's information that perhaps can help in terms of the discussion and the committee when they want to understand what is early childhood. What is the difference between early childhood, what is referred to in the United States as the pre-K debates. A lot of publications, a lot of books written about this. So we're not the only ones here in the Northwest Territory struggling and looking at different ways in terms of what is the early childhood, what is the best bang for the buck. So I hope to give some of that information that can help you, and I think it perhaps it will spur some further interest. And you'll be on your computer looking away for a lot of this information. So, the briefing note was developed from a number of views and points expressed since 2014 about the proposed changes to early childhood programming with the Junior K rollout and concerned early childhood practitioners in the Northwest Territories who I am in contact with in most of the territory. In the last 3 years, the GNWT has taken the step toward universal school-based programming for all NW children ages 3 when they start, if their birthdays are between September and December. So those are the 3-year-olds that could be entering a Junior K program in a school and into their fourth year. This is otherwise known as Junior K. Other places it's known as pre-K. In the United States, a lot of the literature it's known as I said, the pre-K debates. The briefing note shares questions and points raised in the last 3 years to the department, communities, and the relative applicability of what is the research. So perhaps I might put you to sleep, hopefully not. In 10 minutes, I'll keep you awake and go over some statistics in terms of what does this research say? What do we know about the cost-benefit analysis of early childhood? And I believe I was here yesterday morning. I did hear some points raised about that as well. So our points are about the unique setting in the north, which does provide a wide geography, a population that is spread out in many small communities. As said previously, there may not be 3 or 4-year-old children for some years. There may not be any births for 3 or 4 years. Birth rates are also declining in some communities, as we do know. And then we also want to sort of phrase our comments and our points to for you to consider and to look further and to ask further questions is about the Indigenous cultural and language diversity that the NWT is perhaps unique in Canada and North America. It's English, French, as well as the many Aboriginal languages where the languages are taught in the schools and where those languages are trying to be revitalized and where many of those young children are learning perhaps English as a second language or even a third language. Many of the points raised have come from various early childhood educators. They've asked me over the years as a licensed clinical psychologist, can you provide some direction for me? Can you explain this to me? What does this early development instrument mean? What does this really say? I've read some stuff in my courses, so that's what I'm framing my comments are. What is the research on universal? I'll be talking about the universal versus targeted programs. What are the savings? What are the cost-benefit analysis? This is why we're here today in early childhood. There is a bang for your buck, but it is a complicated story, and it does require detail to understand it. The table below, which is on the second page, will frame the two questions. The first one is, why is there so much focus on 3- and 4-year-olds? The reason why is for the last, since 1965, there has been over 50 years, if you can do the math, of actually research, mostly in the United States. There are some Canadian studies as well that have looked at where is the best bang for our buck when it comes to whether we invest in 0 to 2, 0 to 3s, 4 and 5s, and that sort of thing. The War on Poverty, which came out of Lyndon Johnson's presidency in 1964-65, was trying to find a way, how do we address our at-risk and our low-income children? How do we provide for them? How do we get them started? And hence the birth of Head Start. But at the same time was actually another project that was starting called the Perry Preschool. This is known as the gold standard for why we are here tonight and why we want to invest in early childhood. So it really talks about universal programming, which everybody versus targeted. What I'm going to be talking about is the cost-benefit work, and what you hear a lot and what I've heard a lot in the NWT is actually targeted research that you're hearing. So when you look at the money that's put in and the savings that come out, that is actually for low-income children. When you look at the studies, when you dig them out, it is for disadvantaged children. It is often urban children living in large cities, such as Chicago, New York. So those are the gold standard studies. Those are the ones that James Heckman, if anyone's heard of him, a number of years, actually in Canada as well, he's a Nobel Prize winner, said, we need to invest in our children as infrastructure. We need to put the money in for our most disadvantaged, because we will get the biggest bang for our buck. So that is the research. The Perry Preschool is the most famous, and it has a 1 staff to 6 children ratio. So the benefits for early childhood are with small groups. And this is for 3- and 4-year-old children. This study is ongoing. These poor children are still being called every 5 years. They're now in their 50s. And they're still getting a phone call from a researcher saying, how are you doing over there? From 1964-65. So the cost of the Perry Preschool, and these are in 2007 dollars, was $15,000 per child. And the cost-benefit return, so for every dollar invested for this study, and this is the research that really gives us our bang for our buck, but again, it's low-income children, disadvantaged children, and half-day programming as well. So the investment is $1 invested in the program, the returns down the road, and it's mostly in the adult years, and it comes from, it's anywhere from $5 to $17. So that's the return. Why, if we put in the money, this is what we're going to save down the road. Where you save the money down the road, if you look in the paragraph further, it's mostly because of reduced crime. And a lot of crime prevention projects were actually funded on this very research. Some of those crime prevention projects also happened in the Northwest Territories. So there's already been a lot of projects based on where can we invest most. If we think of how for low-income children, unfortunately, the trajectories for them, for mental health, for health reasons, and for involvement in crime, that's where the costs come up. So that's where the best bang for your buck is with targeted programs. The other two studies that are often quoted that people forget about, but if you're a statistician, I mention them here. Chicago Parent Centers, they actually do a very unique outreach program. They are based in their return for the dollar, oh, I didn't write it down, is $1 in for $3, $7 savings. So the school-based Chicago Parent Centers had a little bit less than the Perry Preschool. The Abecedarian one is a 0-5 at a much more expensive price tag. It's closer to $45,000 per child. It's a full-day program. Those children are also being followed for 40, 50 years, and the net savings for $1 invested is $3. So it really depends on the program. So when people such as myself talk about why the quality is important, you get what you pay for. And the ratio of staffing is what makes Perry Preschool the, what's called the gold standard. It's a staff ratio of one staff to six children. And those are three-year-old children, four-year-old children. They also go through the summer. There also is a parent outreach program. So that's where you get the long-term benefits and savings. The second part that I want to mention today is about the EDI. And this one I get asked probably a question a day. I had about two or three today as well. What is the EDI? I'll give you a brief few comments and then you can ask questions if you like. There is a sheet that I believe is the current one on the GNWT website. I am a clinical psychologist. This is what I do. I do testing. I don't do a lot of it in the NWT, and there's a reason for that, is because of the cultural diversity in the Northwest Territories. So as psychologists, we're trained either at the master's or doctoral level. And we are only allowed, we're only licensed to use certain tests and certain measures and certain types of screens when they're with different populations. And we're only licensed and skilled and trained to do it with populations where the norms match the tool. Now, this may seem like a technical point. I feel it's a very important point for people to be aware of. Any data is data. So the questions have been asked, is this good data that we have with the EDI in the North? And that's been asked for the last two or three years. A number of points that I'll raise here, I raise questions. As a clinical psychologist, it actually is my ethical obligation to raise questions about if data is good or bad when it comes to young children and it comes to tools or measures that I may or may not use. So since 2014, there has been many questions, not just for myself as psychologists and others. Early childhood educators have some limited training. I know some teachers as well. I sat in a session in 2014 that also raised questions. So a few of them that we've raised is that the consent process that's used in the current day with children and families, we almost always use what's called an informed consent process, where the parent has a say, the parent has input, the parent knows what is being collected on their child. There's a number of different Canadian standards for that, research standards, and so on. So our question has been that the consent process is questioned with the use of the EDI in the NWT. How information is shared. We have actually very limited information on this because there is a one page on the website. The HELP website, which is the BC affiliate for the EDI, has much more extensive information about what the EDI is, the consent process, how parents can ask questions, and so on. So we have concerns about that. You say, well, why is it important to have a consent process? It has to do with our obligations as children are from their parents, and the parents have a right to know the information that's collected on them. In recent years as well, it's been raised with a lot of Indigenous groups. If information or data is collected without their knowing, this raises some serious ethics questions. So we've asked repeatedly for more information. Why does this process seem to be somewhat different in the NWT and so on? The other part we've asked about is why are not some of the Indigenous and cultural linguistic differences considered? This is done with the UBC project with EDI. It's not being done, as we can see from the information we're provided in the Northwest Territories. So some people have said, a few parents actually have said, I don't even know what that is. Where is it? Was it collected on my child? I don't know. And I actually have limited information to say, look on the website here. It looks like it's collected in the kindergarten year. This is what it is on the UBC website. This is what it is on the McMaster website. There is supposedly what we call a passive consent form that goes home in a backpack. But the parent does not directly, what we understand, we haven't had it verified in terms of that the actual direct consent has come from the parent and that they're involved in what is being done with their child on this rating form. Some of the information that we see presented here, it says the EDI is used in all provinces and territories. That's incorrect. If you go on McMaster's website, UBC's website, they will identify they are the copyright holders. They clearly explain where it is used. From what I saw today, it's used in Ontario for a limited sample as well as BC. Nunavut has specifically decided not to use the EDI. In conversations with another clinical psychologist, it has to do with the linguistic and cultural diversity issues. The other part that is questionable from the EDI in terms of programming is that it, and this is the UBC copy of it, is it's done on the individual child, so the teacher rates them in the second part of the school year. That's standardized. But it does not look at the program. So it's not looking at junior K, it's not looking at the preschool, it's not looking at the Head Start. In the test business, for anyone that's aware or has been tested before, there are hundreds of different tools. There are probably thousands of different tools, and they all have their merits, their pluses and minuses. Usually the task is you want to find out what is your question, what are you looking for, what are your limitations, what are some of the ethics questions, what are the cultural linguistic differences, and then you select the tool based on the question you want to have answered. The other way to do it is you select the tool, and then you hope that it answers your questions. That is actually not a good way to do it, because any data can say anything that you would like it to say. So from my perspective as a clinical psychologist, the EDI is a rating scale. That is what it is. It's a teacher rating scale. I don't see the references to how it looks at the program of either a three-year-old program or a four-year-old program. Now, anybody can make their extrapolations. I have questioned some of those extrapolations. The last part that I'd like to say on the EDI, and then I'll leave it for questions, is that there are many reasons why the EDI, why the numbers can be. I think there's concern. We're all concerned. I work with young children. I work with parents. I work with families. I work with elders. We are all concerned. We all want the best for children. So the numbers that have been put out for the NWT, I question if those are accurate. That's my personal opinion, and I'm not representing anybody other than myself as an individual licensed psychologist in the NWT for that. The norm groups that have been used are, for the most part, not in the Northwest Territories. So the numbers could be worse, they could be better. We actually don't know. It's a rating scale as well, so it's an opinion. It's not a measure with the child. Often when you're trying to look at program or policy, you'll have a number of different measures. And there comes the limitation for the NWT, is that it's limited funds, limited population. So one database could just give you one direction. It's not giving you perhaps all of the information you need. So in closure for this part, my suggestion, recommendation, the continued use of the EDI should be reviewed for ethics procedures and questions raised across the NWT about cultural and linguistic reference and relevance. The administration should be reviewed and the analysis as tied to early childhood programs and services. The last part that I'll mention is an extra it's called the Sense of Identity Questionnaire, and it actually is on a public website, so you can access it. It's in the listing as still being used in the Northwest Territories. In previous sessions with the department, a number of concerns were raised about why is this tool, this additional measure, why is it being used, who is it being used for in the North? It's not used in the rest of Canada. It asks questions such as, a child can name their own culture, a child can wears traditional clothing, child takes part in cultural practices and traditions, child recognizes traditional cultural foods, child has had on-the-land experiences, child feels like they belong to a culture, child demonstrates pride in their culture, child demonstrates a sense of family, a sense of identity. These are five-year-old children. As a clinical psychologist, I look at these questions and I say this is mostly a grade 6 and up level of questioning. This is not things that 4- and 5-year-olds would be developing. They are still developing who they are, their identity. So I really question how this is adding, and it says on the website that this is adding to the EDI and the NWT. It's not used in the other EDI sites in BC or McMaster. There is some documentation. There's an article written from the authors of the EDI about why it was came together, and I would refer you to that information to look further. We've had briefings with some Aboriginal leaders, and we'll continue because we as well would like to get their feedback, and it is parents that these are the ratings being provided by the kindergarten teachers. The kindergarten teachers may or may not be from the community. Do they know these things? Do they know what cultural legends are? So these are the types of issues. This is what gives the credibility issues and what we call the validity issues in question for the EDI database, as well as the sense of identity. I had actually thought, from what I've been told, this wasn't going to be used anymore based on input from 2 years ago. It is currently still on. There's no further information to know if this information is still being collected on kindergarten children. So I close on that. I thank you for your comments. I didn't leave Joyce much time.
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. Ms. McLeod?
Thank you. I just wanted to say that on November 29th, we did have a public meeting in Fort Providence, and that same questionnaire that Jennifer had brought up, a lot of the parents had questions on those too. They were wondering, you know, their children are going to be tracked, and if their children are going to be tracked for life, you know, on I guess on that sense of identity questionnaire, and they wanted to know if all of the, not only the Aboriginal students, but they wanted to know if everyone, the non-Aboriginal children, were getting that questionnaire as well, and there is just a lot of questions to that, so they wanted some answers. They were kind of curious about that. So,
hello. At this point in time, does any of my colleagues have questions? Mr. Beaulieu.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I have a question to a doctor. In your opinion, do you think that EDI is a good indication of success or failure in the future?
Thank you, Mr. Beaulieu. Dr. Chalmers.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As far as in my professional opinion and in reviewing the EDI, it is not a strong enough measure. It is a child measure. It's also a rating scale, so it doesn't actually look at measuring what the child is able to do. So it's based on an opinion of a staff, of a teacher. It has a manual. It does what we call correlate with some tools. With most of them, it's at a lower level than you would like to see if you're making decisions about programming. There are many, many other measures. They do cost more money, and that's probably the reason why the EDI is used in certain jurisdictions, because it is one of the most inexpensive databases to run, because you can collect it quickly. The predictive validity is limited, in my opinion, of the EDI. It does not look at the program. It does not have it's a one data point, so there's no pre and post. There's no control groups. So you're really, what are you measuring? And really, the database and what they say on the websites is it's a snapshot in time. It's a population measure. It's not meant to monitor programming. There's many, many other measures for that would look at the program.
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. Mr. Beaulieu.
Thank you. Two questions. Are there other types of evaluations later on? And do you think that the EDI, and if there are other evaluations, is used to determine the level of inclusive schooling?
Thank you, Mr. Beaulieu.
Sorry.
Dr. Chalmers.
In terms of the special needs, on the EDI, it's actually, it's not questioned. They are not part of the database. And I'm not sure how that information is dealt with in the NWT, because there's limited information to look at the database, where those children are counted or included. On the EDI, and it's on the website, on the UBC website, you can see that the teacher writes at the bottom, does the child have a diagnosed special need from a psychologist or a medical doctor or somebody else? So it wouldn't go into the database. It wouldn't go into those total numbers you're seeing. So the numbers we are seeing from the NWT, I'm not sure if those children are included or not.
Thank you,
or if they've been excluded.
Thank you. Ms. Green.
Thank you. To continue on with Tom's questions, if the EDI is not an appropriate tool, what would be a better choice?
Thank you, Ms. Green. Dr. Chalmers.
Thank you for the question. Perhaps I'll clarify as well. It's a tool. Every tool has its merits. It's a population measure, so it gives you that one-time snapshot. My concern comes is when that one-time population data, which you should be only looking at larger communities, you should not be looking at smaller communities, is really not your best option to look at program quality and pre and post how the children are doing before they start the program and when they finish or later on. So there's no progress measure. The also limitation with EDI, it is a rating scale. So in the field, when it comes to measures and data, rating scales are a little bit on the lower end. They are the cheaper ways because you don't have to hire people like myself and other statistician people to do the measures. So they're inexpensive, but they actually give you perhaps one piece. Often a rating scale is done with perhaps two or three others. An avenue to look at, especially as you start a new initiative, is to look to universities and look to other partners. They are usually bursting at the seams to try to want to find. They usually have to fund it as well. But a new program is a great opportunity to look at those. But you do need to know your baseline. The EDI right now is not giving you a it's kind of being used as the baseline, but there's nothing else. In terms of that. Now, out of UBC, if you look on their website, they do have some other measures that they are currently pilot testing in elementary grades, and I think they also have a youth one that's not available as of yet. Again, a rating scale done by classroom teachers.
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. Ms. Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So what I'm trying to get at is the government has chosen this measure, which you've spoken about at length, as a means of determining where children are at in different segments of their development. So if EDI is not a good choice for the reasons that you've explained, what would be a better choice to use for that age group of four or five-year-olds? Is there an instrument that could track them through their whole school career? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Green. Dr. Chalmers.
Just like the studies that I mentioned, the gold standard studies, there are hundreds of tools to look at. The issue will come for the NWT is to find those that consider the cultural and linguistic diversity. There's questions on the EDI that particularly ask about, can the child do this in English? What is their level in English? So we'd want to, and this is the work that I've done across Canada in terms of working with culturally linguistic diverse populations, is finding what I call the least offensive tool that gives you some of the what you're asking for. To give you offhand right now, it really depends on how much money you have. Doesn't that sound awful? We're talking about money tonight, and I'm bringing up more money issues. It costs money. So in some ways, and different tools, you know, have different levels of screening, different levels of skill. The reason why rating scales are often used is because you don't have to have skill. You don't have to be a master's. You don't have to be a psychologist. So you're getting, you know, sort of that type of data, which it's useful. It's not maybe telling you the whole picture. EDI is not going to be able to track. Some of the also the clusters or the areas in EDI, I, as a licensed psychologist, again, in the NWT, have questions on the physical health one in the front. It doesn't correlate well with other measures. It's not looking at health indicators. One example is the physical health area is looking at whether the child has a coat. It's looking at whether the child is late for school. Now, these things in the background are relevant to physical health, but it's you're not actually getting what you think you're getting. So that's the issue with tools. I could talk to you all night and put you to sleep. I probably have already put some of you to sleep on this. Tools are what they are. You know, just like you take a tool to use in your garage or to fix your car. It's how you use it and what you want to use it for. So my recommendation is to go back and look at what are you trying to do. If you want to track children over a number of years, this one is designed only to collect in the kindergarten year and towards the end of the kindergarten year, February, March, April. It does not look at the program, although you could infer that, you could do that, and that's where, you know, I would take another half an hour to explain some of the statistics about why there's problems with that. You can't say just because I like peanut butter this morning on my toast on Facebook, 50% said yes and 50% said no. What does that mean? So that's the analysis part. So we have to be careful with any data. What does it mean? And that's where the skill and expertise comes to know what is the tool, what's its limitations, what's all of its background. Here's a manual just on EDI, on all that statistical part, the stuff that I do as a clinical psychologist, and then see, does that tool fit your question? And even if you do do it, here's the limitations. I have yet to hear any limitations. There should always be limitations on data when you're doing it for young children. The other issue you raised, not to continue on, is that 4 and 5 year old children are a challenge to test because they're moving targets. So the early years are particularly problematic for tracking. What the gold standard studies do is they find ones that usually focus on language. They usually pick 4 or 5 smaller, shorter ones that can be done at 1 or 2 year intervals. And they're done following the children either at usually at entry to school, not sort of before, but they're done by qualified teams. They're often done by research teams out of universities that do that sort of thing.
Thank you, Dr. Tromer. Any other questions for these two witnesses? Mr. Van Tine.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Dr. Chalmers, for coming and sharing this information with us. And while I have you here, and this is going to be just slightly off topic, but we struggle with, as a territory, not only identifying, but also then having to deal with young kids suffering from FASD. And so anytime I try to ask around it or find out more data or information, the challenge always becomes that those who may be considered to have FASD don't admittedly suggest that they even have it or admit or want to admit that they have it or what have you. And so, nor would they do it for their kid necessarily. So while I have you here, I'm trying to determine, because as you might have discovered earlier, I'm also concerned about the funding that might be required to apply to 4-year-olds in the new JK program. And so I'm trying to get a better sense of inclusive schooling. And I know that FASD is a big question mark out there. So what kind of instruments or tools are available to start to more accurately identify those with FASD so that we can help overcome the systemic challenge of teaching and those who are challenged with FASD.
Thank you, Mr. Thine. Dr. Chambers?
Sorry, how long would you like to stay tonight? and I get asked this question a lot. I'm sitting on a plane and someone starts asking and you say what you do. Lately I just say I'm a consultant and then I don't get asked some of those things. But and I've worked in the North for 22 years. I also work in other jurisdictions in Canada. The FASD question as well as the autism spectrum question, if we get into a diagnostic issue, is a very particular, very sensitive area as well. There are physical criteria. Myself as a psychologist, I do not diagnose FASD, so it's off combined with a physical pediatric issue, pediatric assessment. But as far as maybe perhaps where I can go, the challenges we see with children with these possible issues as well as others are still ours to deal with, whether we have a diagnosis or not. And that's often what I, when I work with schools, what I'm saying is try not to get hung up on, do we need the autism diagnosis? Do we need the fetal alcohol? Often in southern jurisdictions, you get the diagnosis, you get the funding. So there's a lot of effort, but those are resources we don't have in the north. The fetal alcohol question, and I believe there is a team at Stanton over the years, you know, it's in one-on-one type of situation. Often the learning challenges, behavioral challenges, physical challenges, I'm going to suggest, and again, it's my personal opinion, we don't often need the diagnosis. We do know the needs are there. So the issue is to say, here's the cognitive issues. Here are the physical issues. We can do that in schools. We can do that in early childhood settings. Just like the Perry Preschool, the earlier, not so much assessment, but the earlier addressing some of those things, and early childhood educators, teachers as well in the younger grades, we don't wait for the diagnosis. To know how much money you need for that, that may be the issue. But you may actually have children that don't have a diagnosis have more needs. So often we break it down, believe it or not, into do they have cognitive needs, physical needs, social, emotional. And we have measures for those things. The early childhood field, I would say the early school year field in the K-1-2, the number of tools, the measures that is open and available to use that can help guide practice as well, is there. I suspect your team that I just kind of was going to be part of that process, the territory-wide piece, can help with that. The numbers for fetal alcohol in the NWT, they say they're perhaps a little higher than southern Canadian jurisdictions. I say the challenges for young children are perhaps a little higher in the NWT. Number of reasons. Poverty is probably the one, housing as well, a number of other issues. So we know that, but we still have these children, don't we? So in the classroom setting, that's where the 1-6 ratio, that's why all those ratios are so important, the number of assistants you have. The early childhood daycare licensing ratios allow for that one-on-one time with these young children, where if you do help them with their language at age 2, 3, 4, long before they reach the EDI timeline, which some say it's almost too late to find out, you know, at age 5, we can start to help at age 2, 3, 4. I think you're absolutely right. Your junior K needs to consider how are you going to be able to ignore when you have now a handful of children that are speech delayed, that may have some behavioral issues, may have some thoughts that maybe there's fetal alcohol here. Fetal alcohol often shows up in terms of the behavioral cognitive issues in the young years. So our measures track that. We don't always have to know why. It could be from autism, it could be from some other reason. So hopefully I answered that, and I only took 5 minutes.
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. That's it. Any other questions? If not, we'd like to... Mr. Blake, sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I believe it is Mr. Wasilch who mentioned earlier that, you know, the department has... asked that the, whether it's JK, and I'll just use that as an example now, take on more 0 to 3 year olds. How would the Head Start program feel with that idea? Or what are your thoughts on that? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blake. Ms. McLeod?
Right now, we don't... get extra dollars. Our building is set up for 3 and 4 year olds. We have all the equipment. We have all the materials. We're licensed for 3 and 4 year olds. And if we have the 0 to 2 year olds come in, our whole the whole program will change drastically. We'll have to have. More money from our funders, I suppose, and probably more money from EC&E, you know, to provide us with help for the children and for the operation and maintenance of the building too, and just everything. So it'll change quite a bit from the children that we do have now, the 3 and 4 year olds. So.
I can give you an answer from the research. Younger children...
Thank you. Ms. McLeod, Dr. Chalmers.
Sorry. Forget all that. I am so sorry. From the research, and this is largely available, again, on the public websites, the younger children cost more. I don't know where our young fellow's gone here, but they actually cost more money. If anyone goes on a plane and, you know, and travels with an infant, a two-year-old, a one-year-old, you have this bag, you have this. Even, you know, for and when we look at our smaller communities, for young children that are reared in a more culturally sensitive way, they stay with their parent. So the actual, the research actually says young children under that those zero to twos are best with their parents. A number of European countries actually fund parental leaves for up to 2 years, recognizing the language development, family, attachment issue, attachment, attachment, attachment. It's zero to two. So to put those children anywhere, whether it be around the world, in a program, we're actually going against what is actually most important for those youngsters. Now, children that are in care, in a child care setting, a lot is made of the ratios, the 1 to 3, and I believe it's 1 to 4 for 2-year-olds, because they need much more nurturing attachment with a similar caregiver. So a lot of issues are put into when you do infant toddler care or programming that you're considering that. Most of the 0 to 3 programming that's in the literature, it's called Early Head Start, is not program-based. It is actually parent and taught programs. It actually is family resource centers. It's family a drop-in programs. We don't really want to take the child away unless we do have to work, and if then, usually it's with a very consistent caregiver and all those things are put in place. So it's a whole different bag, and young children cost a lot more money. The Abecedarian was a $45,000 price tag per child for a 0 to 3, compared to the Perry Preschool, which was $15,000.
Thank you, Dr. Chalmers. Any other questions? If not, I'd like to thank Ms. McLeod and Dr. Chalmers for presenting today. And then I would like to invite Mr. Oliver, the president of the NWT Teachers Association, and Mr. MRO Assistant Executive Director for the NWT Teachers Association. And thank you very much.
They don't have a prepared text here.
Yeah. Mr. Oliver.
Thank you, Chair. And I know it's been a long day for everybody. And I knew I had a cold today, so as soon as I got here, I knew my throat would act up and... So please bear with me. I'm here to represent the 800 teachers of the Northwest Territories Teachers Association. And recently, Adrian and I traveled across to many of the schools across the Northwest Territories, visiting our principals and our teachers, of which many of you represent those ridings. I think in a 2-week period, Adrian and I drove the equivalent of Yellowknife to Dallas, Texas. And so I got to see him more than my wife, but it was really enriching for us to see our members and talk. And JK is the number one issue on not only the administrators' minds, but personnel as well. And you know, you've heard presentations here tonight talk about funding, about you want, the suggestion is provide 14 years of education in 13 years of funding. And That adds to our workload of teachers. And recently, the government teachers and YK1 have ratified an agreement that made significant increases in teacher and student wellness and is moving forward to reduce teacher workload, because we want teachers to stay in the North. We know that retention is a big issue for our teachers and our small communities. The more the teachers are retained in small communities, the better success students will have. And so we want that. And so that's important to us. And we're also concerned about being funded less for teachers, because it seems like we're being asked to do more with less. Well, that goes against our contracts that we recently signed about increasing student and teacher wellness and reducing workload. So the NWTTA supports the implementation of junior kindergarten for all schools at the start of the 2017-2018 school year. As long as it's fully funded and it is not detrimental to any other programs in our schools and does not lead to teacher layoffs. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. You're a pretty face. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Oliver. Members, do you have any questions for Mr. Oliver? Okay. Well, thank you very much. Thank you. At this point in time, I'd like to thank all the presenters here today that took the time out to present to us and to the general public for attending our meeting. I thank you very much for your support and the information provided to us today. At this point in time, I ask you guys to, if you could leave, and I'll ask our committee to sit. Sorry. Written submissions. Apologize about written submissions. At that point in time, if you have written submissions, if we could get them to Doug Showerty, he's the clerk, by December 16th. We've had a number of written submissions to my colleagues that we will be collecting that data and using that information as our committee moves forward through the Education Act and junior kindergarten and other avenues there. Is there anybody that wishes to speak? As Doug didn't give me any other names. So if not, I again thank you very much for your time and have a good rest of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you.